Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, we're going to have a brief introduction to some ideas of linguistics, the study of language. Now, if we're studying language, one thing that we might do is break it down into pieces. One way we could do this would be to break it down into the individual sounds that make up the language. So these would be called the phonemes. So phonemes are all of the sounds that are used within a language to make all of the words that exist in that language. So in English, for instance, we have about 40 phonemes that we use. There's about 40 different sounds that you can use to make all of the words in English. Now, other languages might have different numbers of phonemes. So there are languages that have just over a dozen phonemes, and there are languages that have almost twice as many phonemes as English. Now, if you've ever studied a foreign language, you might be aware of some of these different phonemes. So for instance, if you were studying Spanish, you might be aware of this double R, this rolled R sound, like in arriba or tierra, right? Now, this is a sound you might struggle with initially because this is a phoneme that is used in Spanish, but it's not used in English. So you don't have much practice making this sound. And so it might be more difficult for you to use this when you first encounter it. Now, of course, there's other phonemes besides just this double R. You know, there's nasal sounds in French that might be difficult for English speakers. Or if you're learning a language like Xhosa that has clicking sounds, you're going to find these difficult initially because you're not used to producing these sounds. And the same would be true for people who are learning English. English has phonemes that their languages may not have, and they might struggle with these. All right, so we'll come back to that in a minute when we talk about accents. Another way we could break a language down is that we could think about meaning. We could break it into meaningful pieces. And so if we do that, we're looking at morphemes. So phonemes refer just to the individual sounds in a language, whereas morphemes refer to meaningful units in the language. Okay, so let's say I look at a word like bat. Okay, now there's multiple phonemes in this word. You know, I have this B sound, I have this T sound at the end of the word. But in terms of morphemes, this is a single unit. In other words, I can't break this down any further and still have meaningful pieces. If I look at another word, however, like Batman, well, now I can say, okay, this is one word, but it's possible to break it down and still have meaningful units left. So I can say, all right, this is actually two morphemes, bat plus man. So one word, but two morphemes. And actually even more, phonemes, right? There's still more sounds in there. We have this M sound, this N sound, right? There's a lot of different sounds, but there's only two meaningful pieces. Now, what about a word like bats? Well, what do we have here? Well, actually, we can break this down further. We can say this is really bat, that's a morpheme, plus this S sound. And even though it's a single letter and it's a single sound, it has meaning in this case, and that makes it a morpheme, right? Morphemes always have meaning. And what's the meaning here? Well, this S, the meaning is it makes it plural. It changes the meaning of bat when you add an S to it. That means that S counts as a morpheme. And this also applies to other things that we add to words to change the meaning. So prefixes and suffixes that change the meaning would still be considered morphemes. So things like pre, you know, whatever, or post. Or at the end of a word, you might add ism, and that makes it a noun, right? And so that changes the meaning, and therefore that ism would still be considered a morpheme. Okay, when we think about combining things in a language, we can combine sounds, of course, in order to make words from all these different phonemes that we have. And there's certain rules to how we combine those sounds. And these are called the phonological rules. And just like phonemes can vary between languages, the rules for combining sounds can vary between languages. And in fact, the rules for combining sounds can vary within a language. So what I mean by that is that we can have regional variation in how we combine particular sounds. So regional accents would be examples of differing phonological rules within the same language. All right, so what would be an example of this? Well, if we think about a sort of stereotypical regional accent in English, we have the Boston accent. All right, so what's going on in the Boston accent? Well, what's happening is there's some slightly different phonological rules that are being applied compared to, say, standard, you know, newscaster English. Okay, so what's one of these rules? What makes this Boston accent noticeable? Well, one of these is, how do you combine certain sounds that have R's in them? So what do you do when you have a word like park? when you have this R here, we have this R followed by a consonant. Well, the standard pronunciation would be to say park. But the Boston variation is to kind of ignore that R. You don't need to really bother to pronounce it very much. So you end up saying something like pock, right? And so this is why you have this, you know, stereotypical phrase for making fun of the Boston accent, which is pock the ka and havid yad. Right? So what you're doing is you're taking all those R's and you're sort of dropping them out. You're changing the rules, the phonological rules, for how you combine those sounds. And as a result, you have this regional accent. Now, you also have accents across languages. So you can have variation by region, or you can carry over the phonological rules. So this happens when somebody learns a new language, but they start applying the phonological rules of their native language. They carry them over to the new language, and as a result, they sound kind of funny, right? So this would happen, for instance, if people are learning English, right? I mentioned, there's different phonemes that are used, like the TH sound that's used in English is not common in a lot of other languages, like we use in the, right? This sound at the beginning of the word is not used in a lot of other languages. As a result, people have difficulty with it, and they carry over some other rule that's close enough from their language. You know, so they say something like z instead of the. That accent is also a result of this differing phonological rules between their native language and the language that they're trying to speak. Now, another example of this would be if you've seen the show An Idiot Abroad with Karl Pilkington. So there's an episode where he goes to China, and they're going to write his name, Karl, in Chinese characters. But there's a problem here in that in Mandarin, they don't have this phoneme where a sound ends in an L, or a word ends in an L sound. So his name, Karl, they don't have a way to end it with that L sound in Chinese characters when they write it, and even when they're speaking. So an L sound in Mandarin is always followed by a vowel. So you can have la, li, le, lu, right? You can have these different sounds, but you can't have L by itself. So when they try to write Karl with Chinese characters, they end up always writing Karla. Right? It always comes out as Karla, because there's no way for them to represent this L sound using Chinese characters, because that's not a phoneme that exists in Mandarin. All right, so that's sort of an explanation of why this happens. Obviously, it's a lot funnier on the show than how I'm describing it. But we can now understand a little bit about why that happens. Okay, the last type of rules I want to look at are what are called syntactical rules. Right, and so the syntactical rules are rules for how we combine words. So phonological rules are how we combine phonemes in order to get words, and syntactical rules are how we combine words to get phrases and sentences. And so there's rules about how we do this, and violating those rules is going to change the meaning. So what would be an example of this? Well, in English, we have a syntactical rule that says, if you want to describe a noun, so you want to have an adjective that describes a noun, almost always, it's going to be the case that the adjective comes before the noun. You say the adjective, and then you say the noun. Right? Now, other languages don't necessarily follow this rule. Spanish has just the opposite rule, where you would put the adjective after the noun. But in English, we generally say it's going to be adjective followed by noun. So if I take two words and I say, okay, yellow banana, right? In English, this means I'm talking about a banana and yellow is describing it. It's a yellow banana. What happens if I flip these? Well, using these same words, the syntactical rules are now going to say that actually what I'm doing here is I'm talking about the color, yellow, and I'm describing it as being banana yellow, right? I'm using banana as an adjective here to describe the color, rather than in this case where I'm using yellow to describe the banana. So just by changing the order of those two words, the syntactical rules are going to change the meaning. Now, it's fairly amazing how easily we learn this. When we're kids, when we first start speaking, when we're 2 years old, we first start stringing words together, we start following these syntactical rules. And this shows that we're learning grammar from a very, very young age. We're picking it up without explicit instruction. We don't need, you know, an English teacher to sit down with us and say, you know, you have to put adjectives before nouns. When you're 2 years old, you don't even know what adjective means, but you're able to start applying these rules. And this tells us something about how language acquisition occurs. And we'll go into that in a future video. Okay, I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.